Welcome to e-Padasala lecture series in computer science, second module. In this module, we are going to talk about the fundamental stages of problem solving. We are also going to see the context of algorithms in the process of solving a given problem. And the aim and objectives of this particular module is to know about the stages of problem solving, to understand the various stages that are involved, to know the characteristics of an efficient algorithm. And as part of this module, we are going to deal with the categorization of algorithms so that the algorithm study taxonomy can be well defined. What are the stages of problem solving? Say, for example, if a problem is given to us, how to deal with the problem solving process? Problem solving is both art as well as science. There are no fixed rules of how to solve a given problem. So, it is the domain of high creativity where novel solutions can be provided with lot of careful thinking. Problem solving can also be stated as a science where there are certain rules that are available to solve the given problems. So, in short, problem solving is both art as well as science. So, in order to formalize the problem solving skills, we have to identify the various steps, and for every step, we have to use some standard principles to know better. So, these are the various stages that are involved. Number one is problem understanding, then algorithm planning, design of algorithms, algorithm verification and validation, algorithm analysis, algorithm implementation, and finally, the postmortem or post analysis of the algorithm development. These are the various stages of any algorithm development. We will concentrate these steps one by one. What is the necessity for problem understanding? There is often a saying is that a well understood problem is solved already in half. So, problem understanding is very important. In algorithm study, the problem understanding deals with the solvability of the given problem. This is a domain called computability theory. Computability theory is a theory where we are trying to bother about whether a given problem can be solvable or not. You may wonder whether this is necessary. This is necessary because there are many problems that cannot be solved at all. Therefore, computability theory becomes a very important substudy of algorithms. As part of this computability theory only, we are bothering about the better understanding of problems, and we are trying to develop some sort of a well-defined problem statement that can serve as the input for the further stages of problem solving. So, this particular domain is what I said as formalized as the computability theory. So, here we are going to bother about the hardness of the problems, where we are going to bother about whether the problem can be solvable or not. The problems that are not solvable in nature are called hard problems. There are two types of hard problems are available. One is analytically hard problems and another is called the computationally hard problems. What is a analytically hard problems? There are many problems which require certain amount of knowledge which we may not possess. These sort of problems are called hard problems. A good example of hard problem is the Turing incomplete problem. So given a algorithm, it is very difficult to say whether the problem will terminate or not. The Turing halting problem is a good example of the analytical hard problems. Similarly, there are certain problems which are computationally very hard. These problems do have algorithms, but it is very difficult to solve problems for a larger instance. For example, in module 1, we talked about the traveling salesperson problem. For smaller instances, TSP problem has got a well-defined algorithm and solutions. But if the number of cities becomes larger and larger, if the number of cities becomes vast, suddenly it is very difficult to solve the problem in computers. These sort of problems are arising because of the limited resources of computers. These problems are called the computational hard problems. So one advantage of a thorough problem understanding is that if the problem comes under the hard category, then perhaps we can suggest some alternative strategies for dealing with these sort of problems. So once the problem is well understood, we have to generate some sort of a problem statement. Then once a problem statement is generated, where if we come to a conclusion that the problem indeed has got a solution, then we can go about the planning of algorithms. So in planning of algorithms, we do these sort of activities. Number one is we are trying to take a choice about the computational devices. So what is a computational device? A computational device is a theoretical or mathematical model. What is the necessity for theoretical model? Say for example, if I try to develop a solution, I should not develop the solution in the context of, let us say, machine X or Y. Similarly, the analysis of the algorithm should not be specific to any one particular configuration as well as the programming environment. In general, the problem design, the algorithm analysis should be independent of any machine or environment. So for this reason only, we are selecting the computational model for implementing these solutions. These are theoretical machines. We can say these are virtual machines, and these machines are not, what you say, realizable in physical form. Two kinds of machines we normally encounter in algorithm study. One is called the random access machine, and another is called the Turing machine. Random access machine is a theoretical machine which has got the large number of registers. It has got the mathematical formalisms, so using which any problem can be implemented as an algorithm. Similarly, Turing machine is also a fantastic virtual machine developed by Alan Turing for solving any given problems. Once a proper computational model is selected, we are going for the selection of data structures. Data structure selection is one of the crucial decisions in algorithm planning. What is a data structure? A data structure deals with the mechanisms of storing and retrieval of data. We encounter lot of data structures in our daily life. For example, a queue is a good example of a data structures. You can see very well in a gas station where let us say if there is only one service center, many vehicles, automatically a sort of data organization is developed in the form of a queue so that the service can be meted out. This is what we are calling as the data organizations. Data organization is a very important issue that influences the algorithm development. A good data structures can make an algorithm very efficient. In other words, data organization is a concern of the algorithm person so that the data can be stored and retrieved very effectively. There is a saying that the algorithm is nothing but the program is nothing but algorithm and data structures. A efficient algorithm with the proper data structures is indeed instrumental in constructing a effective program. This is stated by Dijkstra as a part of his book, and this is indeed taken as a concrete statement in algorithm development. Any wrong selection of data structures can lead to a faulty or inefficient algorithms. That is why in algorithm planning stage, we give lot of importance for the careful selection of data structures. So, the solutions can be exact, the solutions can be approximate also. Say for example, if the problem is of a simple type, then we can provide the exact solutions, and if the problem is very hard, then we can go for some sort of approximate solutions. Once the planning is over, then we are coming to the next stage called algorithm design. So, in this particular stage, we are going to develop some sort of a decision strategy to solve the given problems. Any problem should be solved in certain manner so that the solution is feasible. That is what we are calling as design strategy, and this is the most creative aspect of any problem solving sequence. So, here we are having lots of strategies in computer science, and we have to apply the suitable strategies for solving the given problems. For example, let us take the simple case of telephone search. For example, somebody is given me a name called Kadir and asked me to search his telephone number in a telephone directory. How we are going about this case in our real world? This is what we are calling as design strategy. One naive method is maybe I can search for his number from page number 1. If I go like this, then it is bound to take lot of time. In short, this is nothing but a linear search. So, for the convenience of retrieval, perhaps we can go for indexed method, then based on the indexing, fine, I can find his number also. This is another strategy. Perhaps I can go for a divide and conquer strategy like binary search. So, I can take the middle part and I can check whether the Kadir comes in the first half of the book or in the later half of the book, and I can proceed and I can locate his telephone number, or perhaps I can go for a interpolation search. So, in an indexed telephone directory, perhaps I can use Q. So, to approximate where should I go, and perhaps I can go and locate his number. In other words, there are no general guidelines about how to go about a particular task. It is based on the experience and the need of the hour. So, based on that, we land upon a strategy which we are calling as the design strategy. So, in this stage, we also specify these design decisions as a document. So, how to generate this document? We can write all the things as a plain statement. Say, for example, I searched for the name Kadir using this procedure in a natural language like English or Tamil. So this is also possible. But the problem with this approach is that the natural language is ambiguous in nature. Every word can convey different meanings to different people in different way. So the instructions which I write may be ambiguous. Therefore, natural language is not generally useful for writing these sort of documents. How about mathematics? Mathematics is a good choice where confusion is not present. But the problem is the documents tend to be more mathematical, and third person or the user may find it very difficult to interpret all the things. And we can use a programming language like C or Java to write the procedures. But the problem is that we are trying to develop algorithm which is biased towards that particular language. Let us say if I write all the algorithm in a Pascal manner, and if a person do not know about Pascal, then he may not able to interpret what this document is all about. So the natural choice is going to be some sort of a pseudocode. So where pseudocode is nothing but the mix of the natural language as well as the mathematics. So all algorithms are normally written in a pseudocode to convey how the problem solving is done. So this is what the general context is all about. There are no general guidelines available of how to write algorithms. Everyone is free to evolve their own way of writing the algorithms. So we will also develop some sort of a consistent style in order to write algorithms. Once the design strategy is over, then once the document is generated, then we are going for the stage called algorithmic verification and validations. So what is a validations? Any algorithm which we write is supposed to generate the expected output. So I will give lots of legal inputs, and I am going to check whether the algorithm is able to generate the expected output or not. If the output is right in the context of the given input, then I can say that algorithm validation is carried out. Then once the validation is over, once I know the algorithmic correctness, then I can go about the verification process. So where I can try to give some sort of a proof about the quality of the algorithm that has been developed. So mathematical proofs are very important in algorithm study. So mathematical proofs are often very rigorous and often better than the scientific experimental methods. In science, normally statements are made based on certain observations, but as observation changes, the statements also do change. So that is the reason why in science often an contradicting conclusions is being made. Compared to that, mathematics proof is often rigorous. It takes a lot of time to generate that, but once it is generated, it is considered as the sacrosanct. So as part of the mathematical verifications, we do develop lot of mathematical proof that the algorithm which we develop is right. So how this verification is carried out? Lots of ways are there. So we will be trying to give proof for algorithms based on assertions. What is an assertion? Assertion is a statement about the problem state or algorithm state. For example, I can use a predicate calculus and I can assert the states of a particular variable in a particular way. So lots of assertions will be given as part of the algorithm, and all the statements in a clear manner, and if I could able to prove that the output, what you say, is taken logically from the input, or in other words, the assertions leads to the correct output or the conclusions, and I can say that the algorithm is right. This is what we are calling as a proof. In other words, proof is nothing but a mathematical statement which states that given the context, the input assertions leads to the desired output. We can also give proof based on the mathematical inductions. Especially this is done with respect to what you say recursive algorithms. You know, recursive algorithm or algorithm that use recursive functions. Good example of recursive functions are like what you say factorial of a number. So for these sort of algorithms, we can give what you say proof based on mathematical inductions. Mathematical inductions define a base class. It defines an inductive class, and we can prove that for these instances the algorithm works. And if we take an inductive leap and proves that the algorithm works for n plus 1 or 2n, then we can say that the algorithm works correctly. This is also one way of giving the proof. Once I know that the algorithm works correctly, in other words, if the correctness of the algorithm is established, then we can go for the next step called algorithm analysis, where we are going to bother about the efficiency of the algorithms. What is the reason for analysis? The real reason is like this. Computers have got lesser resources. So, every program is supposed to take a lot of resources. So, we have to optimize. So, given the limited resources, we have to ensure that the program runs. So, algorithm analysis is normally done in two contexts. One is to develop efficiency of a given algorithm. Second is we have to provide some sort of a comparative framework so that we can compare algorithms and we can say which algorithm is best. In other words, the context is given a problem, I have to develop algorithm A, then if necessary, I should be able to compare algorithm A with all other algorithm to quantify whether my developed algorithm is right or not. This is what we are calling as the algorithmic complexity theory. So, algorithmic complexity theory is the field of algorithm that deals with analysis of solutions in terms of computational resources and optimizations. So, this is a very important study like computational complexity, where we are trying to bother about the analysis of algorithms. How to compare algorithms or how to analyze algorithms? For that, we require some sort of measures so that we can make assessment and comparisons. These measures are of two types. One is subjective measures and another is objective measures. What is a subjective measure? Subjective measures refers to ease of implementation and algorithm style. Say for example, if I give a problem to a class of 30 students, 30 students will develop algorithm in different manner. So, how can I compare all the things? So, I require some sort of a measure. Maybe I can use the algorithm style and I can say which algorithm is better. This is a good approach, but often can lead to problems. The reason is subjective measures change from person to person. Therefore, I require some sort of objective measure. Objective measures are related to time, space. It can refer to any resources like bandwidth, cache hit, etc., etc. So, normally we use time or space in order to characterize the efficiency of the algorithms. We will see what is the time complexity. Time complexity measures the time taken by the algorithm for an scaled input. In short, we are trying to estimate how much time will be taken by the developed algorithm A. So, when we say time, we have to be very precise. There are two types of time measures. One is called as execution or compile time, and another is called run time. So, execution time or compilation time is the time that is required for compilation, and that is not important for algorithm study, because an algorithm can be implemented as a program and can be compiled multiple times. Therefore, we are more bothered about runtime only. In other words, runtime is the time that is taken by the algorithm to produce the results. So, time complexity measures how much time that is taken by the algorithm to produce the result. So, once time complexity is over, then we will do space complexity, where we will try to measure the amount of space that is required by the algorithm. Once analysis is over, then we will try to implement these as part of a program. Programs are nothing but algorithms in action. We try to choose a programming language to implement these algorithms. Once the program is available, then we will try to, what you say, do the postmortem analysis, where we will try to find the answers for these theoretical questions. This post analysis is very important to have a hindsight about the problem solving process. So, here we will try to know about the limits of the given algorithm. We will also know the theoretical limit of the given algorithm. We will try to analyze whether the given algorithm is efficient or not. And then we will try to make a study about whether any other algorithms are available for solving this particular problem. In other words, we can say that problem solving is a cyclic process. It is not a linear flow, because in any stage we will encounter a problem that can force us to backtrack to the cycle, where we will try to rectify all the things. In other words, the problem solving is a cyclic process. And in algorithms, normally we will classify the algorithms so that we will make a deeper study. There are plenty of ways of classifying the algorithms. So, we can classify algorithm based on the implementation, design and tractability. One popular way of classifying the algorithm is to classify algorithms as iterative algorithms and recursive algorithms. Iterative algorithms are deductive in nature, and recursive algorithms are the algorithm that use recursive functions. The recursive function is a function that calls itself conditionally. The good example of recursive algorithm is factorial of a number. So, this is one way of classifying the algorithms. Another way of classifying algorithms is based on implementation using the context of processes. This is classified as the sequential algorithms and parallel algorithms. Similarly, based on the solutions, algorithm can be classified as exact or approximate. For harder problems, the approximate algorithms are relevant, because the exact solution may take lot of time. Similarly, based on the implementation, we can classify the algorithms as the deterministic algorithms and randomized algorithms. In deterministic algorithm, there is a guarantee that algorithm will terminate, and in randomized algorithm, there is no such guarantee can be given. Similarly, based on the design, we can classify the algorithms based on the strategies. The algorithm study is replete with lots of design strategies like divide and conquer, greedy approach, dynamic programming, etc. In the subsequent modules, we are going to deal a lot about these paradigms. Similarly, we can classify the algorithms based on the problem types as string algorithms, sorting algorithms, searching algorithms, graph algorithms, combinatorial algorithms, etc. So in the further modules, we are going to deal with these sort of problems, where we are going to specifically deal with how to solve this problem using the given design strategy. Similarly, based on the tractability, we can classify algorithms as polynomial algorithms and exponential algorithms. Polynomial algorithms are algorithms that can be solved by the computer in a limited time and space. And exponential algorithms are algorithms that defy all the things. In other words, it is very difficult to give you a meaningful solutions given the limited amount of resources. In short, we can say that these are the classification of algorithms. In summary, we can say that problem solving process is very important for algorithm study. You have lots of stages, and we have seen that problem understanding, design and analysis are the most crucial aspects of any algorithm study, and it is also necessary to classify the algorithm based on various constraints so that we can have the complete knowledge about the algorithm development. These are the various references. Thank you very much for being with me for this particular module. In the subsequent modules, we are going to deal with various algorithmic analysis as well as the design concepts. Thank you very much.